minutes or so south of Houston. So close to a good cultural hub, but we got our own hub down where I'm at in Lake Jackson. As you can see, I work in copper for the most part. I do some sterling silver as well. My presentation, I kind of wrote it as if I am giving you guys advice while I'm sharing my story. So a lot of you should do's and you shouldn't do's, but bear with me. So let's get started. All right, so before graduation hits off, it's important you have your groundwork set up as soon as possible. Guys, the print shop here is amazing, and you guys get a really great rate for your prints. So take advantage of it. Work with them, get it to where you want it. Get your high quality prints made for your physical portfolio. There have been so many times that I've been out and about fairs, festivals, just going and viewing other people's artwork, and my phone won't load my pictures. I have no idea why, because it did yesterday. So having that physical copy, something to carry around that says, hey, yeah, this is my work, is really, really useful and time saving. And it's usually one of the first questions I get is, so do you have a portfolio? Do you have a website? So a website's really important. And there are tons of domains and stuff that give you free ones, that give you paid ones. I mean, there's a lot of options out there for you. Another thing I recommend is your business card before you get done with school, guys. Especially those of y'all that have unique names for your art, or in my case, you can't spell my name without you having seen it at least 3 times. So a business card is really, really useful. Finally, I'd say you guys need to get a goal for what you want to do after college. After you get out, the post-graduation slump hits in, and if you don't have something to work towards, you might just quit. It's really hard to know. My goal when I got done with college was to find some place I fit at. I had a really supportive husband, but it took 2 years before I finally said, hey, I found it. And then we moved 8 months later. So, you know, it's good to have a good goal. Also, because of how difficult it is to be a full-time artist, you're probably going to be working another job. So if you have a goal to focus on for your artwork while you're juggling this other job, it helps you stay focused. Because art and your other job, you're working 2 jobs. So go ahead, you have to give yourself a goal and, you know, stay on it. Financially supporting yourself while maintaining a constant flow of marketing and creating is, like I said, the equivalent of 2 jobs. This is where post-graduation burnout, like I was talking about. So I found the easiest ways for me to get back into it was to carry my sketchbook. Even if it's just the smallest one you can find, carry a sketchbook with you. And then I flood my social media with other people's work. Pinterest, Facebook, all of that. You go on there and you will find artwork on my feed before you'll find anybody else, because that's what keeps me motivated. And then also keep your unfinished projects out in the open. It's easy to push it in the back burner if you can't see it. So, next slide, which is my support group slide. It's good for you to encourage your supporters to promote your artwork like they did your Girl Scout cookies. My father-in-law has sold 3 paintings for my sister-in-law, and my husband has snagged 3 commissions for me in the last year that he's been working at his new job. That's just them marketing for me. That's not even if I was going around doing anything. Your support group, there's family, like I just mentioned, but also your friends. Guys, if you've got people here that you're going to school with, keep in touch. Even if you don't even share the same medium, it is so helpful to have someone that you can call up and say, oh my gosh, so-and-so at the Art League said this about my work. how do I take that? What do I? Some want to talk about the nuances of being in the art world, even if it's a different medium. Online communities as well are incredibly helpful. For me specifically, I'm part of the Aspiring Metalsmiths Facebook page. This is a page for anyone who even dabbles in metal, and they are really helpful for terminology. Like, I've jumped into the art world and in the jewelry world, and I don't know half the terminology that these guys were throwing around. And I could ask questions and they would answer, and they were nice about it. They were, you know, they're a very good support community. And if I share a finished piece, they're always there and ready to give feedback and critique, but in a positive way. But it's a good, like I said, it's a good community, the online community. You should definitely find a way to plug in. But don't limit yourself to just your medium. I'm also a member of the Lapidary Facebook page because I love the stones and I love to see them. I have a stash of slabs that I have done trades with. I will trade a slab, cut me a couple stones out of this, you can keep the rest, and that keeps my work flowing, but also I get to dabble over in Lapidary a little bit. So that's your online groups. Your next one is your local art leagues and stuff. I'm gonna harp on this one because I didn't believe it when I left here. And now that I've been in two myself, I'm like, oh my gosh, I should have done this way earlier. So the first league I joined was in Bay City, a little town in Texas. I was the freshest face there, so they said, hey, do all these things, and I said, okay. I got to teach watercolor classes with children. I don't watercolor, it's not really my thing, but I started teaching with them, and I've discovered I kind of like watercolor again. So there's that side of it. I also got the opportunity, because it was a small league, they had some tragedy strike one of their members. And she was the gallery director for their the art league. It's stationed in a small older house, and we have the entire first floor dedicated to the gallery. So when I said, hey, I've got some experience at hanging, you know, I work studied, and we do it twice a year for the shows. Mm-hmm. So then I've got some experience. They said, good, you're acting gallery director. Okay. You know, nothing official, nothing on actual documented paperwork, but I got to hang two shows, and I got to be in charge of the maintenance and figure out, you know, how to keep this place looking nice, because no one had taken the time to make it look nice. So, another thing about art leagues that was really helpful is you connect with other artists. So by going through the art league, I found a couple of other artists who wanted to share a booth space at a local art fair. So I've never done that before. I was real nervous. Oh no, am I gonna do a tent or something? I didn't know. One of them had a tent, someone else had tables, someone else had walls to put up artwork on, and we all got together, we split the fees, and we really just dived in, and I wouldn't have found those people if I had not been a part of the art league. So this leads me to my next slide, which is networking. Now, networking is kind of an abstract. I mean, we can say what the definition is, obviously, but it's kind of abstract until you actually go through it yourself. My personal experience was through the Bay City Art League, like I mentioned. I met this lady named Linda. Linda was this bubbly, bouncy, full of enthusiasm lady who said, what do you do? And I was like, okay, well, I do this. And I shared a little bit of it. And she's like, oh, okay. We swapped business cards when she left to go finish her errands, and didn't think anything of it. Let's see, probably a month later, I was hanging one of the shows. She came in and was like, you know, we could really use you over at Lake Jackson. I think your stuff would look great over there. We need you over there. Oh, okay, you know, kind of, you know, forceful. She was more of a force to be reckoned with, but, you know, she was super nice. emailed me probably a week later saying that there was a sunset sip, which was a art walk down in Freeport, a little tiny town that's really trying to get its art community going again. It was an invitation only event for artists. So basically she said, hey, are you interested? You know what, sure, why not? It was a free, there was no entry fee, which you won't run into very often. And it was indoors, so I didn't need a tent, I didn't need a whole lot of materials. So she vouched for me, even though for me, she'd never seen me actually do anything. And I got my invitation. Excuse me. When I moved again, I moved to Lake Jackson where she lives at, and she became my contact for getting into the Lake Jackson Art League. So that is the full circle of networking, guys. So that was a local artist kind of networking thing. Businesses are also a very useful place to start creating connections. When I was living with my in-laws in Katy, Texas, I stumbled across a jewelry supply slash art shop slash special occasions venue. It was this modge podge place. They had a full metalsmithing studio. They had all of the machinery, they had the torches, they had the kilns, they had everything. And I was like, hey, how do I get plugged into this? They charged for you to come in and use the space, but if you taught, you could use the space at a different rate or something. It was an interesting little gimmick to try to get people to come in and use the space, use the facilities. I inquired about teaching. I had never taught before, but I was curious, how does it work, whatnot. And the nice lady that was in charge of that particular facility said, we don't really have any space for teachers right now. Okay, well, I'm kind of broke, so I can't afford your fees, you know. So she suggested that I go talk to the owner. The owner said, hey, what can you offer me? You know, how can we work this out so that you can use the space? I said, well, I have artwork. You know, the other lady said, hey, I can sell some stuff. So she looked at my work, and I ended up getting a, lost the word. Wholesale offer, where she buys the work at cost, I sell it to her, and she can sell it for whatever price she wants to. So that was my first experience with wholesale. Had to give myself a crash course on wholesale versus retail versus any of that, because there's a difference and I really didn't know that. But I did end up selling three or four separate pieces. Some of it was jewelry. One of them was a larger sculpture piece. Wasn't something I ended up pursuing a great deal, but I have some experience in it now and I know what I expect when I say, hey, yes, I want to sell wholesale here. So look for businesses that offer that sort of thing, because there are a bunch of them. Another way that businesses aid in networking is, and you guys might be familiar with it in downtown Chickasha, some businesses let you hang your artwork up in their space. They get decorations for their work, their space, and you get foot traffic, exposure, that sort of thing. That's another way to get your name out there. That option's a bit of a roundabout way to connect with people, as it relies on the customer to come to you, but it still gets your name out there, and that's how businesses can help you out. Okay, so I've mentioned displaying your pieces in shops, but you should also be working to show your pieces in galleries and museums and art fairs, and I've touched on art fairs a little bit. Also, for those of you who focus on thematic arts in like fan art for movies and games and whatnot, consider the cons, your local comic conventions. But I'm going to talk about shops or booths run by you at local or neighboring arts and crafts fairs. because this is where I've gotten the most traffic at for my work. I always thought maybe, you know, the internet was the best way to get the most traffic, but it really isn't. It's been down in the dirt next to these people as they walk past. So for those of you that have never done a booth before, I highly suggest it. It is a really interesting experience, even if you decide it's not for you. And find someone to go in with. It is kind of heavy on front costs. You have to pay for the booth space. You have to pay for your tent. You have to pay for all sorts of stuff. It's a financial commitment. So test it out with someone so you can share some of the burdens of the cost. I have found that the most daunting aspect of the show is that financial front. Running your own booth requires a significant amount of forethought and planning. Buying a tent can be relatively inexpensive. The real research and costs come from displaying your work in approachable, eye-catching, and sellable way. You have to consider lighting and arrangement, and it gets a little overwhelming. Visibility, sudden weather changes, all of that. Are you going to use a card reader? Are you going to use cash? So it can be a little overwhelming, but the thing that I found to be totally worth it, because it costs money, it costs time, and you may not sell anything that day. That's the most, like, oh my gosh. You get real life feedback from people. You know, when you show your stuff online and stuff, you might get a like, but you don't actually know what they actually thought. Unless they take the time to actually type it out for you, you don't know what they're thinking about your work. You don't know what kind of stuff is working and what isn't working. But when I'm out in the booth and stuff, I get to see what is their initial reaction. I've had people ask me, hey, have you done clip-ons? Have you done bigger hoops on these things, on my earring pieces? I found out that they prefer my simpler copper earrings over my more dramatic ones, but they like my more dramatic necklaces. I don't know why, really, but that's what I've discovered. But meanwhile, my sculptures are there for curb appeal. I hardly get any actual inquiries about the sculptures, but that's what draws them in. So, you know, that's booths for you. You can't know about the opportunities to get your work out there if you're not regularly researching and participating in your local arts community. And I have no doubt that Jackie or Lane or any of the other professors have mentioned OVAC. I didn't research into OVAC while I was in school, and I'm kicking myself, or I kicked myself, because they have a lot of resources. So I encourage you, at the bare minimum, read their free online stuff. Callforentry.org is a site dedicated to advertising and applying to competitions, residency opportunities, and public art proposals or requests. And I encourage you to consider competitions as a means to getting your work noticed and keeping your skills sharp. I've participated in the International Lute & Brain Full Form Competition 3 or 4 years now, and I've placed in the judges or the jurors' choice category twice, at three pieces total, getting the recognition. Kind of like really cool, honestly, because I have work online that's infinitely online. I don't, you know, it'll always be there. Sometimes there are charges for your entries, but the sense of accomplishment when the entry gets noticed is really good for that artist's psyche. It really encouraged me to keep going. But as well as an encouragement, it also gave me some feedback on what people look for. My photography skills on my jewelry and my artwork needed some tweaking after the first couple of competitions. I realized the way I'm photographing this stuff isn't working, because I could look at my photographs and I could look at their photographs, and Theirs felt crisp, felt clean, it felt professional. It was simple, but it was enough. There was something about the way they were photographing that I knew I had to step up my game if I wanted to actually continue competing. So it's a great opportunity to compare yourself and to look at what you need to improve on and what you are doing okay on. So there's that. I'll put a couple more resources up there that aren't state specific. Texas has a lot of state specific stuff. I don't know how many of you guys actually plan on going to Texas, but here's some non-specific ones that are good resources just to even just reading stuff.
You good?
I'm all done.